Hi guys! It's Halloween month! Yay! Many thanks for joining me. If you are new here, hi, I'm Kat and I like to talk about crimes, investigations and all sorts of things. Please don't forget to hit that big red subscribe button below. Also make sure you hit the notification bell so you are the first one to know about any new videos I upload. And for my returning subscribers and viewers, I would like to thank you ever so much for all the support you're continuously showing me and for all those lovely comments I always read from you. Thank you. Today, I want to talk to you about the killer clowns. But before we get started, here is the disclaimer. I do not mean to be disrespectful to anyone I talk about in this video. The video is for educational and entertainment purposes only. The information I collect is from the internet. I compile all this information into a video. And from the video, you guys are more than welcome to draw your own conclusions. Thank you. A magic combination of childhood fears, social media and psychology fueled the spread of clown sightings all around the world. The terrifying clown panic of 2016 began in the UK on Friday the 30th of September. The police in Newcastle received reports of someone dressed like a creepy clown jumping out of bushes to scare children off. Over the next following days, more than six other cases are being reported. Teenage clown is arrested in possession of a bladed weapon. On the 5th of October, tabloids start to spread that the terrifying clown craze hit these shores. And it begins. The first named victim is 17-year-old student Megan Bell, who had an extreme fear of clowns and she is chased down the road at night. More clowns are popping up everywhere, in Wales, Manchester, Sheffield and Liverpool, then just about everywhere. Worried parents take it to Facebook, they make pages and they start spreading the word. The Metropolitan Police at this point is advising kids to call 999 if they see a killer clown. But these were hardly killer clowns, you know, they were just messing about. There was barely any report of any physical assaults. But the idea of being chased up at night by clowns is scary enough as it is. Metropolitan Police Commander Julian Bennett points out, and I quote, "Antisocial behavior can leave people feeling scared, anxious and intimidated, and I would urge those who are causing fear and alarm to carefully consider the impact their actions have on others." End of quote. So why clowns and why now, as in why in 2016, right? It all started in the US, where since August of the same year, people dressed up in clowns just popping out everywhere. It's widely speculated this was in fact a PR move for the upcoming release of a movie version of Stephen King's 1986 horror novel It, which features the world-known clown Pennywise. However, the idea of a killer clown is all too real if you know the history of John Wayne Gacy. John was born in Chicago on the 17th of March 1942. He was always despised by his father, always calling him a pussy and abusing him, and he abused him since he was 4 years old. His dad would often whip him with a belt. When John was seven, he was abused by a family member, but he never told anyone. He was too scared he will be beaten. Quite from an early age, John realized he's gay, but in the 50s, this was still taboo. So he pretended to be straight throughout his entire life. John had a heart condition which limited his physical ability and gave him lifelong obesity. Half of his youth would be spent in hospitals, and at age 11, doctors discovered he had a blood clot on his brain, which they treated, but even that didn't stop his dad from being abusive. After getting sick and tired of the abuse, John moves out west. He works as a mortuary assistant in Las Vegas, and he spends his nights sleeping on a bed just behind the embalming room. On this particular night, he is observing the... Oh, that scared me. Oh my God. I'm talking about dead bodies and this thing start. Oh, okay. On this particular night, he is observing the morticians embalming dead bodies and he becomes fascinated. So he crawls into a coffin with a dead body where he lays for some time, hugging and caressing the body, which is of a teenage boy. I mean, I find it really disgusting, honestly. I mean, imagine just laying next to the cold, stiff body of a dead person. Oh! And hugging them and touching them. Ew! I don't even want to think about it. Oh! Okay. Oh. John was so shocked of how he felt that he left the job and enrolled into business school after only a few months in Vegas. He never tells anyone about his night with a dead body. John then graduates from Northwestern Business College and he tries to lead a normal life. He meets Marilyn Myers, a co-worker at a shoe company in Springfield, Illinois. They marry in 1964 and he takes over his father-in-law Kentucky Fried Chicken franchise in Waterloo, Iowa, where the couple live with her parents. John and Marilyn have two children and they seem to lead a perfectly normal life. So, what happened to John to turn him into the killer clown? Trying to satisfy his dark desires, he joins the Waterloo Jaycees, a group of businessmen involved in wife swapping, prostitution, drug abuse and pornography. John also opens a club in the basement of his house which targets teenagers. He would let them drink and play pool without getting into trouble. Detective Sergeant Jason Moran of the Cook County Sheriff's Office said years later, and I quote, "He often would build up trust with his victims so they wouldn't need to be on guard. He was their employer, their friend. He may have been someone who provided them with alcohol and drugs and maybe a place to sleep at night. That's an easy way to kill someone." End of quote. 16-year-old Timothy McCoy meets John at the Chicago bus stop on the 1st of January 1972, and John lets him spend the night at his place while he makes his way to Iowa after spending Christmas in Michigan. The next morning, on January the 2nd, Timothy wakes up early to cook breakfast for John as a thank you for helping him. He gets out the bacon and the eggs and sets the table for two. He goes up the stairs towards John's bedroom, not realizing that he is in fact still holding the knife he just used in the kitchen. John sees Timothy with the knife and he panics. Without realizing the boy didn't want any harm, John stabs him in the chest, killing him. He then buries his body in his crawl space beneath his home and covers the grave in concrete. This self-defense killing will change John's life forever. Allegedly, killing Timothy gave John a mind-numbing orgasm, and even though the murder was by mistake or in self-defense, it gave John the ultimate thrill which he would crave forever. Over the next 6 years, he would kill at least 12 people and more bodies would join Timothy's. All this time, John pretends to be an outstanding member of the community. He performs at parties and hospitals as Pogo the Clown. John begins forcing some of the teenagers that would visit his club in the basement to perform sexual acts on him, including some young men that would be employed at KFC, the franchise John took over from his father-in-law. Yes, it's the same KFC. In August 1967, John hires 50-year-old Donald Voorhees, the son of another member of the JC's, the Gentleman Club. He's taking Donald on to do some housework. But John can't help himself, so he lures him in the basement, keeps giving him alcohol and forces Donald to perform oral sex. You see, John, he's the kind of person who I think really analyzed these teenager behaviors. He was a teenager himself at one point, obviously. He knows as teenagers they are not allowed to drink alcohol, party and stuff like that, especially in the 50s, 60s, 70s. So what he does? He is creating this so-called safe haven where boys can do everything they are not allowed to do elsewhere, everything their parents forbid them to do. And we know how teenagers are. They are curious. They just want to try things, you know, something they haven't done before. They want to know how it feels like drinking. Perhaps they see or hear other boys doing prohibited things. And then they want to try as well. You know, if teenagers are the majority of time forbidden from doing certain things, they will eventually rebel and still do it. I mean, it's just how we are. You know, the more you keep someone like restricted to do things, the more that restriction will make them want to do more and more and more until they are old enough and they just leave and they just try their own. It's like keeping a dog in a cage for so long, and then once that dog escapes that cage, they're gone. And the way that John earns this boy's trust is by giving them just that. Just the thing that their parents and the society as a whole wouldn't allow them to. After being sexually abused by John, Donald kept quiet until March 1968, the following year. This is when he tells his dad about John, which leads to an investigation that unveils the mask for John, the one he's been building throughout the years. So now we have John, who is trying to deal with the situation, right? He's paying a KFC employee $300 to beat Donald, to scare him off from testifying in court. But then Donald escapes the beating and reports the beating, which only makes it worse for John's case. In December of the same year, John pleads guilty to oral sodomy. And you need to understand, in those times, in those years, sexual relations between people of the same sex was illegal in Iowa. So John is sentenced to 10 years in jail. This forces his wife to file for divorce, and John never sees her again. Just 2 years after his sentencing, John is released on parole for model behavior. During his stay in prison, John secures raises for prison mess hall workers, increases membership of the prison JCs, the club, to 600 members, works to improve conditions for prisoners, and oversees the installation of a mini golf course in the recreation yard. Throughout his whole stay in prison, he's pretending to be straight to avoid the wrath of the other prisoners. He's given 12 months probation, but with conditions. He has to live with his mother in Chicago and maintain a 10 p.m. curfew, to which he agrees. Just a few months after his release, John lives with his mother in Des Plaines, Illinois. It's here where he lures a teenage boy and tries to rape him. He's charged with sexual assault, but the charges are later dismissed after the boy doesn't show up in court. This means John violated his parole, but weirdly enough, his parole officer never finds out about it. By 1971, John settles into a yellow brick ranch house in Norwood Park in northwestern Chicago at 8213 West Summerdale Avenue. This would become the graveyard for 29 young men and boys. It's this place where he would commit all of the murders, and also the same place where he's to be known as Pogo the Clown. Whilst in prison, John becomes sort of an artist, and he always seems to be sketching the image of Pogo the Clown. After he's released from prison, he joins the Jolly Joker Club, a clown club which usually performs at birthday parties and hospitals. John teaches himself how to apply clown makeup and is looking to become Pogo the Clown, just like he imagined in his drawings in prison. He performs as Pogo the Clown at many events, including local parties, Democratic Party functions, and charitable events. You would think by this point that he's trying to live a life free of crime. He would even show up at his favorite bar, the Good Luck Lounge, dressed as Pogo the Clown. He would bounce kids on his knees and knock on your door to ask you to vote for his candidate. He seems to be, you know, a great character to be around, but his high school sweetheart and second wife, Carol Hoff, who he married in 1972, is not fooled by him. She always questioned his sexuality. And in 1975, when John tells her that he's bisexual, she can't accept it and she divorces him, leaving him alone in their house. Although Carol later denied knowing of what was to come, she admitted to authorities that she saw John bring in teenage boys on various occasions in their garage. It's in the same year Carol marries John, in 1972, that he killed Timothy McCoy, the boy that he killed in self-defense. He stashed his body under their home in the crawl space. And it seems John killed a second person while being married with Carol, but the victim was never identified. He said he hid the body in his closet, and when it began leaking, he buried it in the crawl space. But it's after his divorce that the killer clown really has the freedom to kill. It's like his divorce actually liberated him. Apart from his last four victims, who he dumped in the river, all of the other victims were buried under his house in the crawl space. John's victims were all teenage boys and young men. He would usually pick the ones which were drifters, out of town, and sometimes teenagers who worked for him. Mostly it would be those boys who people in the area didn't know. He would sometimes impersonate an officer to lure the boys in his car. Other times he would lure them by offering a job, give them money or a place to party. Once he would have his victim, John would coax them with drugs and alcohol, sometimes even a dirty magic trick, and then he'd handcuff them and dangle the keys in their faces. Allegedly, before killing them, he would dress in Pogo the Clown, and that's how he would torture them. He would then torture, rape, and murder them. One of John's favorite acts of torture was to sit on his victim with all of his weight, and he was a heavy person, and forced the victim to fellate him. He would strangle and then revive his victims. Sometimes he would even partially drown them in his bathtub. He was the type of killer who enjoyed the process leading to the murder rather than the killing itself. He would strangle the victim and then revive the victim. I think he wanted to see that fear in the victim's eyes as he would strangle them, the life leaving them, but then he would revive them so the victim would be relieved he changed his mind and saved them, only to go through with it. It somewhat gave John a feeling of supremacy. He loved literally holding life and death into his hands, and he would thrive on it. This was like a game to John. He would enjoy it so much that he would take his time before the killing. Some of John's victims were reported missing persons, and he would even join the search parties as he was friendly with the parents and considered an outstanding member of the community. John set himself up to kill, unsuspected, but his 33rd killing didn't go as planned, which would be his demise. December 11th, 1978, 9 p.m. Elizabeth Pist drives to pick up her son from work. Robert is a high school sophomore and honor roll student, but also works at a pharmacy in Des Plaines. Robert goes outside and tells his mom to wait for him a few minutes. He wants to talk to someone about a summer contracting job, which would pay him double than the pharmacy. And this is the very last time Elizabeth sees her son. Elizabeth goes to the police station to file a missing persons report. Police figure out the man Robert spoke to is John, whose company, PDM Contractors, just remodeled the pharmacy. John's being called to the station and he goes, of course, but not before dumping Robert's body into the Plain River. Within hours, the authorities search John's house. They don't find any bodies, but they do find proof John was at the pharmacy after they see a receipt which belonged to one of his friends. 10 years after his first sodomy conviction, on December 22, 1978, John Gacy, the killer clown, confesses to murdering dozens of young men and boys. The police storm his house and find 29 bodies in the crawl space, some of them so badly decomposed they can't be identified, so dental experts are brought in to try and identify the victims by their teeth. 3 years later, the killer clown uses an insanity plea, hoping for a no guilty verdict, but the jury is not buying it. John Wayne Gacy is sentenced to death. He didn't seem to show any remorse to any of the killings. His lawyer, Sam Amirante, said, and I quote, He could talk about a child who's dying of cancer and cry like a baby about this child he didn't even know or never met and feel authentically sad about this child. Then he'd talk about another child that he murdered and have no feelings whatsoever. End of quote. John Gacy would spend 14 years in prison before being executed, and the night before he was put to death, he ordered as his last meal a bucket of KFC, his father-in-law franchise he was running. According to various reports, John's last words were, "Kiss my ass." Yeah, kiss my ass. So you're about to die and this are your last words, okay. John's house eventually got demolished. Most of the victims retrieved from his crawl space were identified and released to their families for burial. However, more than 20 years later, there were still victims who are not yet identified. In July 2017, John's last victim was identified, but sadly, his family had already passed away. Six of John Gacy's victims remain anonymous. This was the story of the real-life killer clown. Many thanks for watching, guys. It's Halloween month. Stay spooked. Bye-bye.